Can a subtle shift in focus really make that big of a difference in your business and in your income? Our guest says absolutely yes. Bob is the author of a number of books on sales, marketing, and influence, with total book sales of well over 1 million copies. His book, The Go-Giver, co-authored with John David Mann, has sold over 500,000 copies, and it has been translated into 21 languages. It has been reissued in a new expanded edition with a foreword by Huffington Post founder and publisher Arianna Huffington. Bob is an advocate, supporter, and defender of the free enterprise system, believing that the amount of money one makes is directly proportionate to how many people they serve. He is also an unapologetic animal fanatic and serves on the board of trustees of Furry Friends Adoption and Clinic in his town of Jupiter, Florida. Thank you so much, Bob, for sharing your time and expertise with our listening audience in this marketing moment.
Hey, Blake, it's great to be with you.
Bob, give us a quick review of the five laws you and your co-author, John David Mann, share in the book.
Sure, and the laws themselves are the laws of value, compensation, influence, authenticity, and receptivity. They all work off of a basic premise in the story, because The Go-Giver is a business parable, a story, and that premise is that shifting your focus, and that's really the key aspect, shifting your focus from getting to giving. And when we say giving in this context, we simply mean constantly and consistently providing value to others, and that doing so is not only a nice way, a pleasant way of conducting business, it's actually a very financially profitable way as well. The five laws themselves, very briefly, the law of value simply says that you're providing such an immense, amazing experience over and above the actual product or service itself that this person feels as though they're receiving much more in use value than what they're paying. Of course, while this happens, you make a very healthy profit yourself. The law of compensation says your income is determined by how many people you serve as well as how you serve them. So while law number one says to give more in value than what you take in payment, law number two tells us that the more people whose lives you touch with the exceptional value you provide, the more money with which you'll be rewarded. Law number three, the law of influence, says your influence is determined by how abundantly you place other people's interests first. And when we say other people's interests first, we don't mean that in a way that makes you a doormat or a martyr or self-sacrificial, not at all. It's simply understanding that all things being equal, people will do business with and refer business to those people they know, like, and trust. And there's no faster, more powerful, or more effective way to elicit those feelings toward you and others than by genuinely and authentically moving from what we call an I focus or me focus to an other focus, looking for ways to make your win all about the other person's win. People who do that truly cultivate a huge level of influence. Law number four, the law of authenticity, simply says that the most valuable gift you have to offer is yourself. While this is almost self-explanatory, it's interesting that so many people don't show up authentically, don't show up as themselves, and it tends to be because they simply don't recognize the unique value that they bring to the table, which is why it's so important to understand our strengths, because then we can lead authentically. Let's face it, it's hard to be authentic when you don't feel you have anything authentic or anything of value to authentically show up for. Law number five is sort of the law that brings it all together. This is the law of receptivity. And it simply says that the key to effective giving is to stay open to receiving. In other words, it's not a matter of are you a giver or a receiver. No, it's both. But the focus is on the giving. You know, we breathe out, but we also have to breathe in, right? It's not one or the other. We breathe out carbon dioxide, but we also breathe in oxygen. Well, we give, but we also receive. Now, when your focus is on the giving, that's great, but all the giving in the world, all the giving of value to others in the world, without the willingness to receive, it makes it really all for naught. So what we say is focus on the giving, but allow the receiving. And this is why we also say that money is simply an echo of
Well, many people have struggled with receiving sometimes, so I'm sure they will really look forward to the input that they'll gain from reading your book on how to find the balance. Now, you make an interesting point in your work that I think we should spend some time on. You say that the go-giver philosophy is totally congruent with human nature. Well, that can be looked at in many ways, not all of them positive. Could you explain?
Sure. Well, and it is congruent with human nature, and the reason why is because as human beings, let's put it this way, and I say this a lot when I speak at a conference, like a sales conference, the first thing I'll say is, you know, nobody's going to buy from you because you have a quota to meet. And, you know, we all laugh because we all know that's true. No one's buying from us because we have a quota, right?
Right.
No one's buying us from because we need the money. And they're not even going to buy from us because we're a really nice person who believes in our product or service. No, they're going to buy from us only because they believe they'll be better off by doing so than by not doing so. That's human nature, and there's nothing wrong with that. Human nature simply says that a person is going to seek happiness. They're going to seek happiness as they, as an individual, understand happiness, and they're going to seek this happiness within the choices that they believe they have. So as a sales professional, our job is to focus on why they would want to buy, not why we would want to sell. And that's why the go-giver, which has such a focus on the other person, is so congruent with human nature. See, as a salesperson, our job is to discover what the other person needs, wants, and desires. And only after we discover that by asking the correct questions and listening, only after that are we able to then tie the benefits of our product or service into what they want, need, or desire.
Well, it sounds like you're really talking about a level of influence in their lives. So one of the principles in your book is influence. How does the go-giver create influence, both personally and in business? And how does that directly relate to new business and even leadership?
Well, it's a good question that you ask because, you know, first, really, we need to define influence. What does it really mean? And on a basic level, we can define influence as the ability to move a person or persons to a desired action. That's the basic definition of influence. Now, that's the definition. I don't in any way believe that is the that is the essence of influence. The essence of influence is pull as opposed to push. Great leaders, great influencers, great salespeople don't push. You rarely hear, you know, hear it said, wow, that person has so much influence, they are so pushy. Wow, we just love them, you know, we'll follow them anywhere, right? No, influence is not about push, it's about gentle pull, it's an attraction. Great influencers attract people to themselves, and then, and only then, to their ideas. And the, you know, the great influencers, because of this, they ask themselves questions to make sure they check their own motives. Again, they understand that, as Dale Carnegie said in his classic, How to Win Friends and Influence People, ultimately, people do things for their reasons, not our reasons. Again, we're talking human nature and understanding human nature and respecting human nature. So with that in mind, the great influencer will ask, they'll ask themselves, how does what I'm asking this person to do, how does it align with their goals, their needs, wants, desires, values? How does what I want this other person to do, you know, benefit them? And when we ask ourselves these questions thoughtfully, intelligently, again, genuinely and authentically, not as a way to manipulate another person into doing our will, but as a way of building everyone in the process, now we've come a lot closer to earning that person's commitment as opposed to trying to depend on compliance, which is never, ever sustainable. I love what my great friend, leadership teacher, speaker, author, Dondi Scumaci says. She says that compliance will never take you where commitment can go. I think that's so brilliant. And
that's,
you know,
really
it reminds
powerful.
Me that great leaders understand that great leadership is never about the leader. influencers know that influence is never about the influencer, and great sales professionals know that, that great salesmanship is never about the salesperson. It's always about the other person. It's about that person whose lives you choose to touch, whose lives you choose to add value to. That's influence.
And many people struggle with what to put out there about themselves and how to balance it with their own needs of moving towards success. Are there misconceptions about being a go-giver and what that is? I mean, the name itself almost implies that you give constantly. And how does someone prove to be a go-giver?
Well, you can give constantly, but that's not the bad thing. What would be negative is if you were just giving yourself away and not creating the context for you to be able to receive. And see, that I think is when there are misperceptions about, and you know, again, it's natural, because you think about it, Blake, the name of the book, The Go-Giver, right? It sounds like, well, just giving yourself away, or, you know, giving everything away for free. Well, of course not. I couldn't really make a living that way, and it probably wouldn't be very productive. So remember, being a go-giver simply means your focus is on providing value to others. That in no way says you're giving yourself away. Now, should we give some information away to someone? Of course, to show and to communicate knowledge or that we can help them, of course. People give away special reports or free chapters of a book. Why? So that people can get a taste of it and really recognize and understand the value. There's also other ways to give value to people. It might be just referring someone to another person. One of my favorite questions when first meeting someone is to ask, how can I know if someone I'm speaking with would be a good prospective client for you? Or it might be, how can I know if someone I'm speaking with is someone you'd like to meet? So there's all sorts of ways we can give value to others without it costing us money, but understanding that it's not a matter of being a go-giver should never be confused with being taken advantage of. It should never be confused with being anybody's doormat or being self-sacrificial in any way. It simply means your focus, your laser focus, is to give value, to provide value to others.
Now, Bob, let's talk about mentorship. First, what's the best way to find a mentor, and perhaps most importantly, why should an up-and-comer, what should an up-and-comer not do when trying to find someone?
Well, we can actually look at that one first, because I think that's important, because it is important to find a mentor, certainly to find. And by the way, there are some people who will be an ongoing mentor. There's some mentors who will mentor for a while. There's no one rule about it, but it's great to find a mentor, because obviously you're able to leverage their experience to help you cut your learning curve. And when that happens, it's a fantastic thing for both people, both the mentor and the protege. What I find a lot of people doing, though, which I believe is a mistake, is when they find someone who they'd like to have as a mentor, and they don't necessarily have any kind of relationship with that person, they'll just simply say, hey, would you be my mentor, right? I need a mentor. Will you be my mentor? And it's sort of like saying to someone, you know, hey, will you share your 30 years of experience with me, even though you don't know me from a hole in the wall, right? Because a mentor-protege relationship, Blake, is just that. It's a relationship. And like any relationship, it takes time to build. It takes time to grow. And so, on the other hand, you can certainly ask anyone, but what you would want to do is, if it's someone who you don't yet have a relationship with, you can certainly let that person know how much you admire and respect their work. You can say that, I'm about to start a business, or I'm just really beginning the track, or you don't have to, just starting of it, what have you, and I realize you're very busy. If I could possibly ask you a couple of very specific questions, I'd greatly appreciate it. Okay, so but what you're doing there is you're letting them know that, you're not asking for the marriage before the date. You're not asking the beer. You're asking if you could ask a couple of very quick, specific questions. And most people will give you the time to do that. But more than that, they will appreciate the fact that you approached them not with a sense of entitlement that they should just be your mentor because you need a mentor, but that you're doing it in a way that respects their time and respects the process. Now, you can ask those questions, and then immediately afterwards, and of course you let them know, you thank them very, and by the way, research them first in these days, there's no excuse not to, of course, with the internet, because you never want to ask them a question that you could have found the answer to yourself by doing some research. That's a time waster for them, and they won't respect that. But, you know, a couple of very specific questions, and then you let them know how much you appreciate it. You'll put it to use right away. You'll keep in touch to let them know, so forth and so on. That very day, I would send a personalized, handwritten thank you note that you put in a number 10 envelope. You say you hand stamp and address send to them that just says, you know, thank you so much for your time. I realize you're very busy. Your advice was priceless. I'll be sure to apply it right away and keep in touch to let you know. Boom. You also might, through their website or through some information on them on a search you're doing, find out that their favorite charity is their local animal shelter. So you make a small, it doesn't have to be big, but a small donation in their name. They will be notified of that. And you're not doing it to kiss up or anything, but you're doing it to, again, just communicate the fact that while you're not in a position to give value to them as they are in the same way they are to you, that you're looking to do that, you know, to make yourself of value to them. If you know they collect antique books on Roman generals or something, you know, you'd find an antique book on it and send it to them, or, you know, whatever. So, and as you start to make your way more and more, you can always give more value to them in that way. But the big thing is for them just to know that it's not something you just expect or feel entitled to, but that you want to be a part of the give and receive as well.
Now, many people who are starting out don't necessarily have a group of resources or networking contacts or even money to provide back. So how does a protege then provide value to his or her mentor when he's in that situation? I mean, certainly they are not always in that position to give value to them.
Well, because you can do little things like that. You know, it might be, again, whether it's a small donation or a book, or it might be that you are able to connect that person with someone, or just a gift certificate for, you know, for $25 for a coffee if you know they drink at Dunkin' Donuts or Starbucks or whatever. And, you know, there's all these things. And if you don't have $25, you're not ready to be in business yet, okay? So we need to be able to invest a little bit in ourselves and so forth. But no, it's not a matter of money, though, in this case. It's really communicating to this person your appreciation, your gratitude, and your desire to be in a position to give value to them.
Sure. Many professionals are looking for more ways to earn. Many people talk on how many touches it takes to make a sale, and people live on how well relationships progress. What advice do you feel most people need to hear today?
We always want to make sure that before every touch we ask ourselves, is this adding value to that person in a way they see it as being of value? Because remember, value is always in the eyes of the beholder. But yes, we should be developing these relationships. And through these relationships, we're then able to ask for and receive referrals. You know, I think that the real thing is when it comes right down to it, and all these are how-to types of things, which are very important. So I would say to people, just as a mentor once told me as I was struggling and that kind of guy with potential, sort of like Joe in The Go-Giver, had the potential but was holding myself back, he said, Burg, if you want to make a lot of money in sales, he said, remember not to have money as your target. Your target is serving others. Now, when you hit the target, he continued, you'll get a reward, and that reward will come in the form of money, and you can do with that money whatever you'd like. But never forget, the money is simply the reward for hitting the target. The target is serving others. And when we do that, now we're headed in the right direction. So if we can keep our focus there on bringing value to others, again, in a way they see of being as being of value, then we're 9 steps ahead of the game in a 10-step game.
What a powerful point to really come to an end of our time together on. I know that folks who are listening are going to rush out and get all the books that you've shared a little bit from, and I'm totally thankful that you have given us this moment in marketing time to really add some true value to the folks who are going to take the time to listen. So thank you so much for your time today.
Oh, it's my absolute pleasure, Blake. I love the work you're doing. Thank you so much.
Thank you. For those folks who'd like more information about Bob Burg, please visit his website, www.thegogiver.com. where you can listen to podcasts and immediately download Chapter 1 from his international bestseller, The Go-Giver, and access lots of value-added resources such as the special report, The Go-Giver Way, 5 Principles of Creating a Culture of Excellence. Making the most of moments with professionals in our lives is very important. I'm Blake Ensign, and this has been Marketing Minutes.